All right, guys. All right. It's almost 7 o'clock. And so I just wanted to give everybody a couple minutes if they're going to join in. What you should see on my screen is, or on your screen, I should say, is also on my screen, is the, are the questions for today's question forum live lecture. And so, like I said, I'm just going to give a couple minutes for people to enter in if they need to. This is being recorded, so if you are watching the recorded version, you can skip ahead a little bit, a minute or two until I get started. Just a couple of reminders. Today is Wednesday, July 4th, so happy 4th of July, yay. Happy Independence Day. You guys have a lot of stuff due on Thursday, so make sure that you're going through and you're looking at your quizzes and your tests and everything that's due for this week. This is the first full week, so you guys have a lot of stuff to look at, so make sure you're doing those. Quick reminder that the quiz for the syllabus and the course schedule are required. They are mandatory that you must do that within the deadline, which is tomorrow, so make sure you get on that if you haven't done it yet. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and get started. Like I said, if somebody comes in, there might be a little bit of a beep sort of thing, but they should be muted, so it shouldn't interrupt anything. So we're going to start with the first question asked. We're going sort of retroactive here. We're going to start with the oldest question first, and that was Jonathan. So Jonathan is asking about identical twins. He's saying they physically develop at similar rates, yet they often have differing personalities. We do have somebody coming in. Hello. You are muted. So if you have any questions, just let me know on chat, and I can unmute you if you need to come in through that. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull my chat up real quick just to make sure that I have it so that I can see what you type if you have any questions. Okay. So can you see my chat, Jared? Can you see my chat box? Jared, can you hear me? Can you like nod or? I don't know. Jared, can you hear me? Okay. I'm not sure if he can hear me or not. But anyway, if you have any questions, just go on chat. All right, so Jonathan's question is about identical twins. He makes the very correct note that their mannerisms and behaviors, including risk-taking behaviors, are typically not the same. And so he wants to know from a neurobiological perspective and the fact that they're coming from similar environments, does their nervous system and prefrontal cortex develop at similar rates? Well, the short answer is technically yes, it's supposed to. The much longer answer is we typically don't see the timing happen exactly the same. Just to kind of make sure everybody's on the same page in terms of twins. So identical twins come from the same egg. It's one egg, one sperm, fertilized, and then it splits into two embryos. With fraternal twins, you have two eggs, two sperm, and so they're essentially siblings sharing the same environment in utero. And so, they tend to share more things because they share the environment in terms of fraternal twins than typical siblings. So when it comes to identical twins, we do typically see that they're not identical. They're identical in physical features, but they do tend to have very differing personalities. Environment does play a big role in terms of timing of things like puberty, prefrontal cortex maturation of the brain in general. So we could have a set of identical twins who are, DNA identical, and then put them in the same environment, as in the same family, but they could actually experience life very differently from one another. So I'll give you guys an example of like Jane and Sue. Okay. So let's say Jane and Sue are identical twins. Jane likes to play the piano and Sue she wants to be a gymnast. Okay. She wants to go to the Olympics. So Jane practices the piano several hours a day. You know, she's super into the piano. She's very, very focused, very determined, and she loves the piano. Whereas Sue practices gymnastics daily, hours a day, very stringent. So they're both doing something that's very extensive, but because Sue is doing something that is very physical, okay, she is actually more likely to be petite and actually much more likely to have delayed puberty. So she may experience delay in her body maturing, whereas her identical twin sister doesn't experience that. She may not be petite. So Jane may be, in the 50th percentile, average height, average weight. She's active for her age. She does everything she, any other kid does. She eats well. And then she might hit puberty at 12, whereas her sister might be petite, very active, eats well, but hits puberty at 17. So we find that the environment can be a really big factor in these kinds of nervous system, prefrontal cortex, puberty, hormonal, all these sorts of different maturation rates can be affected by the environment. We know that obesity affects puberty timing. We know that malnutrition affects puberty timing. We know that having a father in the home is going to affect puberty timing. So the environment is a really big factor. DNA is a big factor. Environment's a big factor. Okay, so it's two major factors. And then we have a third factor, which is the interaction between the environment and genetics. So this is referred to as epigenetics, which is translated above genetics. So we can actually see an interaction between how a person lives their life and what kinds of genes get turned on and off. So you can have identical twins, and they've actually done a relatively recent study on this where they followed identical twin women and noticed that as they aged, they actually became less and less alike to each other in terms of their genes that get switched on and off. So you've got this DNA, this sort of template. But your environment can turn certain genes on and off, what you expose yourself to, how you live your life, and then that can affect, your health risks. You can have one twin that is healthy, both twins are healthy, but one smokes. They may both have a predisposition to lung cancer, but because one of them smoked, they set off a cascade of triggers and genes that ended up leading them to have lung cancer. So what we find is that even though you have twins who are identical, they're not going to experience life 100% the same, even if they live in the same house, have the same family, have the same likes and things like that. So it's something to keep in mind that the short answer is technically yes, if you only look at genetics, that they should mature in the same time and in the same way. But we often find that that's not the case. And that, of course, that environment plays a major role in affecting the DNA methylation and the different genes switching on and off. So hopefully they answered your question. It's kind of, twins are fascinating, and genes and DNA and all that, super fascinating, but it is extremely complex, and there aren't any really good yes or no answers to some of those kinds of questions. Because, you can even get into twins, identical twins, did they share the same gestational sac? How close was their actual in utero environment? It's crazy. But I do love those questions, because I do find that sort of thing pretty fascinating. So, are there any questions about that? Or any follow-up or anything about that? Are we good? Okay. I don't see anything on chat, so it looks like we're pretty good. Okay, so Jonathan, if you're watching this recorded version and you have any other questions, you can always email me. Or if anybody's watching this and needs clarification, just shoot me an email and I'd be happy to further explain. Okay, so Z asked a question about correlational studies. And this is a really good question, because I think that I don't think that we talk a lot about, we talk about these research methods, but we don't talk a lot about when they're used. So Z asks about these correlational studies. She's, you know, you're absolutely right in what you're saying. You're 100% correct. It shows the strength between two variables. And you know, you're looking at what that relationship is. If there's an association, the strength, the direction, that's exactly what you get from correlational studies. And you're absolutely right. And Jonathan actually answers this question very, very well in his description of what the correlational model can show. You're both absolutely right. I think where the question comes in is why use it? So correlation is a research method that we use to look at associations. And we typically use it because either a causal method is unethical, or it's too hard to do, or we don't have that information. So with correlational research, you cannot show causation. You can't show that variable A causes B. You can only say that A and B have some sort of relationship, because there may be a variable C that's causing something, or a variable XYZ that's causing something. So because we can't make that causal relationship, that old saying, correlation does not equal causation, comes in. It's just showing association. So we only use correlational research methods in cases like, for example, let's say we have a pregnant woman and we want to know if drinking alcohol is going to affect the baby, okay? It is 100% unethical to say, oh, hey, you're pregnant, here's a bunch of alcohol, how about you drink this? We'll see what happens. That would be an experimental method of having the woman actually consume the alcohol, testing how much alcohol is in her system, and then looking at the effects of the baby. Because then you could say, this is all we did. We gave her alcohol, and we can now see this is what happens when you give somebody alcohol. So that's a manipulation, and that's an experimental research method. That's incredibly unethical. So instead of doing something like that, we'll get somebody who comes in and says, you know, I drank while I was pregnant. And so we look at, for example, the kinds of behavioral and physical things that we see in a baby, and then we will relate it to how much the woman drank. And so then we, during pregnancy. So then what we can do is actually get an association there. We say, oh, well, we can see that this is related to that. We don't know if it was caused by this because we didn't do a manipulation, but we can say that there is a strong or weak relationship or no relationship, or, you know, this is positively affected potentially by that, you know, so we can get associations with correlational method, but there's no way for us to say that it actually caused it. So when we use correlational methods, sometimes we use it because it's just next to impossible to do an experimental study, or it's really hard or really expensive. You know, when we do, for example, longitudinal experimental studies where we're manipulating something over a period of time, that costs a lot of money and a lot of time. So we would love to be able to follow people over the course of their life and say, you know, the things that they're consuming affects them this way, their habits are affecting them this way. So instead, what we tend to do is just try to take out little pockets and ask them about past behavior and ask them about what they do. And so we make these observations, and then we use statistics to try to link things up, because it's really hard to follow people over a long period of time. You know, people tend to not like to stay with experimental studies, for example, even if they could. They tend to move, they die, you know, they lose interest, all sorts of things. So really it stems back to correlation method really being used when we can't do experimental method. And it's used a lot. In fact, most of the epidemiological studies that we see, like studies about health and linking how people behave and what they consume and how that affects if they're going to, you know, have a risk for diabetes, if they have heart disease, if they have, you know, if they've had a stroke. Looking at a lot of these health behaviors, we can look at what those people do and what kinds of problems they have, and then we associate those together because that's a much easier way to look at things. So when at all possible, we do try to do experimental methods, because that is the only research method where we can actually say causation, A causes B, because we're actually manipulating something. So Z and Jonathan, you're both absolutely right. Z, your example about, looking at a relationship between somebody thinking they're pretty and having high self-esteem. How do we know that they think they're pretty because of the high self-esteem, or the high self-esteem makes them pretty? You know, it would be difficult to do a really good experimental study with that because, for example, that might hurt somebody's self-esteem. Well, we don't want to cause harm. We never want to cause harm when possible in human or animal studies. I'm sure there have been plenty of studies that have done similarly experimentally that can look at that. But, you know, these types of studies where we want to be careful about protecting the participant, we typically just do correlational and just ask them questions. So both of you are right on track. Both of you have described it beautifully, but we only use it when we really can't do experimental work. So again, if there are any questions, you know, you guys can email me. I don't see any questions on chat, so I think we're good there. Any final comments or anything like that? I'm going to kind of wait just a few seconds. And because the way that these go is I just answer the questions. And if there aren't any other follow-up questions, then that's the lecture. So, if there aren't any additional questions or clarifications, then I'll go ahead and end the lecture. Are we good with that? We good? Okay, great. Have a happy 4th. Thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you next week.